One major transformation profoundly affecting the global economy is the way that big data and artificial intelligence are being used in commerce and business. What's gotten less attention, how this decision is driving changes in the creative industries. In the second of two pieces, special correspondent and Washington Post columnist Catherine Rampell looks at some of the fundamental questions this is raising for artists, designers, and other creators. It's part of our regular series, Making Sense.
This bright, cheerful clothing line is a hot commodity worn by the likes of Michelle Obama, Aidy Bryant, Taylor Swift, Beyonce.
People wear us to be happy.
Tanya Taylor is undoubtedly creative, an artist who paints original prints for her clothes. But she's in demand partly because she gives customers what they want.
To me, the biggest part about being a successful designer is absolutely listening to a customer and knowing who they are.
And she knows what they want because they tell her, quite explicitly.
So what do you guys do with your closet space now that you rent the runway?
Thanks to the detailed feedback she receives from Rent the Runway. It's a platform that allows customers to rent rather than buy designer clothes.
Endless styles, infinite possibilities.
We basically have harnessed millions of data points over the last decade.
Sarah Tam is Rent the Runway's chief merchant officer.
Every item of clothing that we have on our site is tagged with over 60 attributes, things like color, fabric, silhouette, length. We also have millions of customer interactions that we collect and millions of photo reviews.
The data help Rent the Runway refine its inventory and predict what its typical customer will want next season.
Last fall, we noticed that blazers really performing extremely well. She loves color and patterns, so we sourced brands like Veronica Beer that we launched on site. She loves fitted. She likes to outfit in suit sets, so we brought in this Veronica Beard set here.
When we think about a Rent the Runway customer, we know
the data also get fed back to designers like Taylor, who use it to nip in the hips or let out the bust, or choose a different color or fabric, or mash up elements of different designs that are working well.
So this was our Inez dress, and it was definitely the most rented dress of our last spring season. And what we learned is that people love the stretch linen, but they didn't love the snap of the neckline. The next step we learned was that people love jumpsuits from Rent the Runway. So we were like, let's combine that information. What we did is we took away the snap, and then it's a little jumpsuit shape.
In a dark neutral print, because that's what the data advised. Access to this kind of feedback significantly improves the chances that a creation will succeed.
The biggest risk for most creators is the risk that what they create will fail.
Law professors Christopher Sprigman and Kau Rostiala have researched how the harvesting of vast troves of data is changing creative industries and what it might mean for their legal protections and economic rewards.
Human creativity has always been an incredibly risky endeavor as a business. If data can lower that risk, it makes creative endeavors easier to invest in, potentially more rewarding.
It's not a guarantee, but they're going to place a better bet.
And you get like little pieces of flamingo.
Creative industries have traditionally had difficulty predicting what will sell and what won't. As screenwriter William Goldman memorably put it in his 1983 memoir, Nobody Knows Anything.
Very simply, people go to see hits because they want to see that movie. They don't go to see flops because they don't want to see that movie. It's as simple as that. And the problem Hollywood has is they can't figure out why.
It's one of the many reasons we see so many sequels. What's worked before will probably work again.
Big data has allowed companies to figure out what works with much more precision, which of course can mean more precise pandering to the masses.
The processes that we're talking about tend not to give you something wildly different. They tend to give you more of what you already watched or listened to or liked.
Keep in mind that there's a bunch of literature on how much novelty people want. And the answer is a relatively modest amount. People like paintings that look somewhat like the paintings they've seen. People like movies that are somewhat like the movies they've seen.
We were just driving.
That said, data has been used to overturn at least some of the conventional wisdom about what and who audiences want to see.
An example is Netflix, which not too long ago produced a film with Sandra Bullock called Bird Box. They cast an older female lead, a relatively diverse cast in this horror film. That's a relatively adventurous choice that turned out to pay off. And the talk among Netflix people was that they did that in response to data.
Listen to me.
A ton of data pulled from more than 100 million users' viewing habits.
Size, scale is very important here. To make use of data, you've got to collect a lot of it.
How replicable is what you do? Could an upstart produce the high quality data and analytics that you have?
I mean, it's not so easily replicable. We have a decade worth of data, along with a lot of the technology that we employ to analyze that data.
This hunger for data might be driving consolidation in creative industries. Take the merger of Time Warner and AT&T.
They went to the judge and they said, look, Time Warner's a programmer, AT&T has a platform. What we need to do is we need to link these things up so that we can get the data to Time Warner that allows them to produce better content.
That might be good for the newly merged company. But, says Sprigman,
if the returns to data keep growing and growing and growing as you get bigger, we could have a pretty strong impetus toward monopoly or at least significant market power, and that's a concern.
Also a concern? Privacy. Consumers may not know their Netflix watching habits, for example, are being closely monitored.
Most people don't realize how much data about their activities, when they're stopping, when they're starting. That's being, in a sense, just gathered up and then spit back at them in different ways, or maybe sold to third parties, which is a concern that a lot of people increasingly have about their data in other contexts.
On the other hand, some customers turn this information over willingly.
Our customers, like 98% of them, give us item level feedback after every time they rent something. So we can understand if our customer loves an item, how it's fitting her, how many times she's wearing it, and where she's wearing it to.
And the customers just provide all of this information to you voluntarily?
Yes, believe it or not, we have built this incredible brand community.
There are other legal questions that arise from this use of big data, like whether we should rethink copyright law, which exists in part to incentivize artists to create.
Copyright is a way of lowering the risk of investing in creative enterprises. If data-driven creativity is lowering that risk, then it will kind of be a helpmate to or even a stand-in for copyright protection.
And who even deserves to own the copyright to a work if it's created by algorithm rather than artist?
The author is now not bringing something out of nothing. The author is kind of conjuring all of our preferences, taking them into account, and in a sense reflecting ourselves back on us. If this shifts people's views of who's responsible for the creative work, where it's more of a community project, then this might shift some of the moral supports that undergird copyright protection.
Yeah, do I own my consumer preferences, or do the companies whose stuff I buy own those preferences?
That is a very current debate over whether you and I own the data that we, in a sense, produce through our activities and that we transmit to these companies.
Artists will argue that they're still running the show.
The algorithm isn't really telling them how to create the art. I think it's just optimizing the art they create.
It wasn't like the data was plugged, it was like fed into a computer
No.
and then boop, 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 like the algorithm spit out this.
I don't think women's minds work in an algorithm, unfortunately. I wish it could be that straightforward and easy. It's more intuition, and you have to read between the lines with the data. Where women are going next is hard to predict.
At least for now. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Catherine Rampell in New York.